welcome afterwards. Are you hearing my voice?
Sir, in person, sir.
Okay, right. Right. So, in the last class, as a part of the history of modern world, we discussed the things regarding imperialism, the colonialism, and the difference between the imperialism and colonialism. And also, we had some discussion over age of imperialism, how we call the old imperialism and the age of new imperialism in the last class. Okay, so as a part of imperialism, we have to be go through the rivalry among the colonial powers and their domination over the Asia and African territories. Okay, so these things we are going to see today, and we'll discuss about the rivalry among colonial powers today. And before going to that, I have to recap the points what we discussed in the last class. Okay, so and imperialism, you are well known that through the Industrial Revolution and nationalism, which shaped European society in the 19th century, imperialism, the domination by one country or people over another group of people, is nothing but a part of colonialism and imperialism. And imperialism and colonialism, both we can use in the same meaning. And those two terms are similar in meaning and having the similar definition, but the scope and somewhat nature is different. Okay, so colonialism, which is you see in the 14th and 15th centuries, and after 14th and 15th centuries, after the development of colonialism, which turned into some imperialistic domination, which we should call as use the term the imperialism. It better to be used in the centuries of 18th and 19th centuries, whereas the political domination over various colonies in Africa and Asia, and where they directly control over whole societies. Okay, so where the imperialism did not begin in the 19th century, and from the 16th to the early 19th, an era dominated by what is now we termed as the old imperialism. And European nations sought trade routes with the Far East and explored the New World and established settlements in the North and South America, as well as in the Southeast Asia. And they set up trading posts and gained footholds on the coasts of Africa and China. Okay, so in the age of new imperialism that began in and around 1870s, and European states established vast empires mainly in Africa and also Asia and Middle East. Okay, so then the conflicts started in between these colonial powers. Okay, so unlike the 16th and 17th centuries, the method of establishing these settlements, the new imperialist setup of the administration of the native areas for the benefit of colonial power, and the European nations pursued an aggressive expansion policy that was motivated by economic needs that were created by Industrial Revolution. Okay, so between the 1870 and 1914, the Europe went through the second stage of Industrial Revolution, where power and use of this fuel has started, and where you see the revolutionary development in the transportation and also the communication has started. Okay, so this, the modern way of communication and transportation, which paved the way for the development of new the imperialism. Okay, so we can use the term the new imperialism for the period between 1870 and 1940. Okay, so and for the new imperialism, there are certain causes we already discussed, like the economic reasons. By 1870s, it became necessary for European industrialized nations to expand their markets globally. And for the sake of military and political reasons, where they also established certain colonies to military power, national security, and as a part of nationalism. And humanitarian and religious goals also important thing. And social Darwinism, we already discussed, according to the Charles Darwin theory on the origin of species. Darwin claimed that all life had evolved into the present state over millions of years, and social Darwinism fostered imperialistic expansion by in that some people were more fit in the sense somewhat advanced than the others. Okay, so they have to be made, follow certain responsibility to develop those backward people. And the Europeans believed that the white race were dominant, and that is only the natural for them to conquer the inferior people or the next race in the world as a nature's way of improving the mankind. Okay, so the conquest of inferior people was just, and the destruction of weaker races was the natural law, according to the Charles Darwin's social Darwinism. Okay, so and the Western technology, it's nothing but the superior technology and improved medical knowledge helped to foster imperialism. It is also one of the cause for this age of which taken place in the age of imperialism. Okay, so and apart from that, there are many causes, and we already discussed as in the last class, and today we will see how the conflicts or the rivalry which taken place in between these colonial powers basically. Okay. Okay, students, we'll see today about the imperialism in Africa, first of all, and then I'll give you the things regarding the rivalry among the colonial powers. Okay, so, and you are well known that in the age of imperialism, there are many territories in the Africa and Asia were under dominance of various European imperialistic countries, and which became those their power was expanded particularly in between 1870 and 1914. Okay, so where when you see the, okay, before going to my explanation, I have to share my screen and then I'll continue my lecture. Students, are you getting my screen?
Saraswan, sir.
Okay, right. So, where the imperialism in Africa, and Africa was known as, you are well known that somewhat dark continent and remained unknown to the outside world until the late 19th century. Because it's interior and desert, mountain, certain geographical isolation you see, and which discouraged exploration, and they are not allowed new personalities or new people into their territories. And Britain's occupation of Egypt and Belgium, penetration to the Congo, which started the race for colonial possession in Africa. And one more reason is that in the 1875, the Britain purchased a controlling interest in the Suez Canal from the bankrupt ruler of Egypt, who was unable to repay loans that he had contracted for the canal and modernization of the country. And the French, who organized the building of Suez Canal under the Ferdinand Lesseps in 1859, owned the other shares, and the Suez Canal was important because it shortened the route from the Europe to South and East Asia, and the canal was provided a lifeline to India, which Britain had made part of the British Empire in 1858. In 1882, Britain established protectorate over Egypt, and which means that government leaders were officials of the Ottoman Empire, but were really controlled by the Great Britain. And the British occupation of Egypt, the richest and most developed land in Africa, set off African fever in Europe. To ensure its domination and stability in the area, Great Britain extended its control over the Sudan as well. Okay, so another one is the exploration of the Congo. And you are well known that 1878, Leopold II of Belgium sent Anglo-American some of a travelers like Henry Stanley to explore the Congo and establish trade agreements with the leaders in the Congo River Basin. And Stanley in 1871 had found the great Scottish explorer and missionary David Livingstone, who had traveled throughout Africa for over 30 years. And when several years passed with a word from him, it was feared that he was dead. Okay, so Stanley was hired in 1869 by New York Herald. He also a journalist, a paperman, who he was hired in 1869 by New York Herald, an American newspaper, to find Livingstone. And his famous greetings, Dr. Livingstone, I presume, became legendary, even though there is some question about its authenticity. And Stanley's account of their meeting made headlines around the world and helped make him famous. And Stanley eventually sold his service to Leopold, who had formed a financial syndicate entitled the International African Association. And a strong-willed monarch, Leopold II's inspection into the Congo area raised questions about the political fate of Africa, South Africa, south of Sahara, and other European nations were fearful that Belgium wanted to extend control over the entire area. Okay, so this exploration and conquest, where the 19th century, much of Africa, Asia, were unknown to Europeans, and the colonial ambitions inspired the search of new territories and led to a number of scientific journeys and geographical exploration. And as a part of this exploration and conquest, we already discussed now about the Henry episode of Henry Stanley and Livingstone, who entered in African territories, and they studied in much about the territories and the geographical richness of the African part. And another one is the Suez Canal. As the episode of Suez Canal gradually, the as a part of this Egypt, Great Britain entered and who started purchasing the shares within the Suez Canal. Okay, so likewise, gradually these European nations gradually entered in the Africa, first of all, and they started exploring the new places and managing these colonies. Okay, so another one is the Scramble of Africa, and Bismarck, the Chancellor of Germany, and Jules Ferry, the Premier of France, and considered the builder of modern French Empire, organized an international conference in Berlin to lay down the basic rules for colonizing Africa. And the Berlin Conference, which taken place in 1885, established the principle that European occupation of African territories had to be based on effective occupation that was recognized by other states, and that no single European power could claim Africa. And the Berlin Conference led to the scramble for Africa. And between 1878 and 1914, European powers divided up the entire African continent, except for the independent countries of Ethiopia and Liberia. And Liberia was settled by free slaves from the United States and became an independent republic in 1847. And Ethiopia, which was already independent and routed an Italian invasion in 1896, and defeating the Italians, assured that the country would stay independent. European countries divided the Africa certain divisions. Okay, so under the domination of France, there are certain areas comes under, like the France had the largest colonial empire in Africa, over 3.5 million square miles, half of which contained the Sahara Desert. In 1830, France had conquered Algeria in North Africa, and between 1881 and 1912, France acquired Tunisia, Morocco, West Africa, and Equatorial Africa. And at its height, the French Empire in Africa was large as continental USA, United States. And when you see the domination of Great Britain, and Britain holdings in Africa were not as large as France, but it controlled the more populated regions, particularly of southern Africa, which contained valuable mineral resources as diamonds and gold. Okay, so and where you are watching on the screen about the African territories, okay, so where these having certain domination over it. And however, the British in 1806, the British displaced the Hollands in South Africa and ruled the Cape Colony. However, the British soon came into conflict with the Boers, okay, so the natives, right? So I will share there that also. Okay, so you can watch on the screen, right? So however, the British soon came into conflict with the Boers, and the original Dutch settlers who resented British rule. And in 1830s, the Boers left the British territory, migrated north, and founded two republics, the Orange Free State and the Transvaal. And the Boers soon came into conflict with the powerful Zulus, a native African ethnic group, for control of the land. And when the Zulus and the Boers were unable to win a decisive victory, the British came involved in the Zulu Wars, and eventually destroyed the Julian Empire. In 1890, Cecil Rhodes, who was born in Great Britain and had become a diamond mine millionaire, became Prime Minister of the Cape Colony, and he wanted to extend the British African Empire from Cape Town to Cairo, and decided to annex the Boer Republic. And in the Boer War, which happened in between 1899-1902, the British with great difficulty defeated the Boers and annexed the two republics. In 1910, Britain combined its South African colonies into the Union of South Africa, and whites ran the government, and the Boers, who outnumbered the British, assumed control. This system laid the foundation of racial segregation that would last until the modern times. Okay, so and when you see the Germany control and late unification delayed Germany's imperialistic ventures, but it also wanted its place in the sun. So Germany took land in eastern and southwestern Africa, and then Italy. Italy was another late entry into the imperialistic venture, and Italy took control of Libya, Italia, Somaliland, and Eritrea, which is the northmost province of Ethiopia near the Red Sea. And Italy's efforts to gain control of Ethiopia ended in bitter defeat. And about when you see the Portugal's domination, and Portugal carved out large colonies in Angola and Mozambique. Okay, so and I will give you some things regarding the imperialism in the Asia, and then I'll move to the exploitation of the colonies there. And the imperialism in Asia, the British, you are well known that India was one of the prey for as a part of imperialism to the European nations. And the British took control of India in 1763 after defeating the French in 7 years war. And the British controlled India through the British East India Company, which ruled with an iron hand. In 1857, an Indian revolt led by native soldiers called Sipais led to an uprising known as the Sipai Mutiny. After suppressing the rebellion, the British government made India part of empire in 1858, according to, you all well know, according to Government of India, Government Act of India 1858. Okay, so as mentioned, as already we are aware, and the British introduced social reforms, advocated education and promoted technology, and Britain profited greatly from India, which was called the crown jewel of British Empire. And the Indian masses, however, continued to live close to starvation, and British had little respect for the native Indian culture. And the Dutch held the Dutch East Indies and extended their control over Indonesia, while the French took over Indonesian Indochina, like Cambodia, Laos, and Vietnam. And the Russians also got involved and extended their control over the area of Persia, Central Asian countries. And when you see the China, since the 17th century, China had isolated itself from rest of the world and refused to adopt Western ways. And the Chinese permitted trade, but only after the port of Canton, where the rights of European merchants were at the whim of the emperor. And imperialism in China began with the First Opium War. You are already well known about this First and Second Opium Wars. And when the Chinese government tried to halt the British from importing opium, and this resulted in a war which Britain's superior military and industrial might easily destroyed the Chinese military forces. And the Treaty of Nanking, which taken place in 1842, which is opened up five ports to the British, gave Britain the island of Hong Kong and forced China to pay a large indemnity. In 1858, China was forced to open up 11 more treaty ports that granted special privileges, such as the right to trade with interior of China and right to supervise the Chinese custom offices. And between 1870 and 1914, the Western nations carved China into spheres of influence, areas in which outside powers claimed exclusive trading rights. France acquired territory in southwestern China. Germany gained the Shandong Peninsula in north part of China, and Russia obtained control of Manchuria and Lee's whole Port Arthur, and the British took control over Yangtze Valley, and the USA, United States, which had not taken part in carving up China because it feared that spheres of influence might hurt US and US commerce, United States commerce and trade, and promoted the open door policy in 1899. And John Hay, the American Secretary of State, proposed that equal trading rights to China be allowed for all nations, and that the territorial integrity of China be respected. Okay, so the open door policy became the cornerstone of its Chinese policy at the beginning of the 20th century. In the 1900, the China was in turmoil. There was rising sentiment against the foreigners because China to give up so many political and economic rights, and this anti-foreign sentiment exploded into the Boxer Rebellion in 1899 and 91. And the Boxers were secret Chinese National Society supported by the Manchu government, and their goal was to drive out all foreigners and restore China to isolation. In June 1900, the Boxers launched a series of attacks against the foreigners and Chinese Christians. They also attacked the foreigner embassies in Beijing. Okay, so such and the Boxer Rebellion failed, but it convinced the Chinese that reforms were necessary. Okay, so in 1911, revolutions broke out across the country, and Manchu Empire was overthrown, and Sun Yat-sen, the father of modern China, proclaimed the republic and was named a new president, and he advocated three-point program of nationalism. Okay, so all these things you are well known. Okay, so another side, the Japan also one of the important country here in the Asian part, and Japan was the only Asian country that did not become victim of imperialism. Okay, so in the 17th and 18th centuries, the Japanese expelled the Europeans from Japan and closed the Japanese ports to trade with the outside world, allowing only the Dutch to trade at Nagasaki. And in 1853, Commodore Matthew Perry, an American naval officer, led an expedition to Japan. He convinced the Shogun, a medieval type ruler, to open ports to trade with the United States. And the painful of domination by foreigner countries, and Japan, unlike China, reversed its policy of isolation and began to modernize by borrowing from the West. Okay, so you can have the things from the Meiji Restoration as a part of the Meiji Restoration, and the Meiji Restoration, which began in 1867, sought to replace the feudal rulers, the Shogun, the increase the power of the emperor. The goal was to make Japan strong enough to compete with the West. The new leaders strengthened the military and transformed Japan into industrial society. And the Japan adopted a constitution based on the Persian model, with the emperor as the head. The government was not intended to promote democracy, but to unite Japan and make it equal to the West. Okay, so the Japans were successful, that became an important power, and the Chino-Japanese war taken place 1894-95, and Japan defeated China and forced to give her up claims in Korea. Japan also gained control of its first colonies, Taiwan and other islands, and shocked the world by defeating Russia in the Russo-Japanese War of 1904 and 5. And Japan's victory was the first time that the Asian countries had defeated European power in over 200 years. Okay, so and when you see the imperialism as a part of this as a part of the consequence of the imperialism. And I will give you because today is only about how the European powers established their colonies in Africa and Asia, and there are already time crossed nearly 40 minutes or like that. And tomorrow I will continue the rivalry between these colonial powers. Okay, so today I will end up with these consequences of imperialism. And the new imperialism changed both Western society and its colonies throughout. Through it, the Western countries established the beginning a global economy in which the transfer of goods, money, and technology had to be regulated in an orderly way to ensure continuous flow of natural resources and cheap labor for the industrial world. And the imperialism adversely affected the colonies, and under the foreign rule, native culture and industry were destroyed, and imported goods wiped out local craft industries, and by using colonies as source of raw materials and markets for manufacturing goods, colonial powers held back the colonies from developing industries. And one reason why the standard of living was so poor in many of these countries was that the natural wealth of these regions had been funneled to transport to the mother countries. And another one is imperialism also brought confrontation between the cultures. By 1900, Western nations had control over most of the globe, and the Europeans were convinced that they had superior cultures and forced the people to accept modern or Western ways. And the pressures to westernize the forced and colonial people to re-evaluate their traditions and to work at discouraging such customs as foot binding in China and sati in India. Okay, so sati was custom in which a victorious woman threw herself into her husband's funeral fire in the hope of that sacrificial act would wipe away the sins of both her husband and herself. So although imperialism exploited and abused colonial people, and Western countries introduced modern medicine that stressed the use of vaccines and more sanitary hygiene that helped to save lives and increase life expectancy. And imperialism created many political problems, and European nations disrupted many traditional political units and united the rival peoples under single government that tried to impose stability and order where local conflicts had existed for years, such as in Nigeria and Rwanda. And ethnic conflicts that developed in the later half of the 20th century in many of these areas can be traced of these imperial policies. And imperialism also contributed to tension among the Western powers and rivalries between the France and Britain over the Sudan, between France and Germany over Morocco, and over the Ottoman Empire contributed to hostile conditions that led to World War I in 1940. Okay, so these are certain consequences about imperialism, new age of imperialism or new form of imperialism. Okay, so dear students, this is end of my class today, and regarding this imperialism and the consequences of imperialism, if you have any doubts or queries, now you are welcome to ask. Doubts unnaya emana?
Em less, sir.
Okay, shall I end my class now?
ओके सर.
ओके राइट थैंक यू.